A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 21st September 2021. So we have seven topics chosen for discussion today. Good news is two topics have been already discussed very recently, so I'm not going to touch upon it. So apart from that, we have five topics chosen for discussion today. Our first topic will be based on National Register of Citizens and its nexus with the Citizenship Amendment Act. We'll be seeing the entire topic in total in the context of the Foreigners Tribunal verdict in the recent context. All right. So it'll be a comprehensive discussion on that, a bit lengthy discussion on that. And our second discussion is going to be based on the ease of doing business. And we know recently the World Bank has scrapped the ease of doing business ranking. So we'll see why was it scrapped, and the author in this editorial has given a critical view of the index in itself. So we'll be looking at that, and our next discussion will be a geography based discussion. We'll be refreshing about Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats. So this particular part of the discussion will be very relevant for those appearing for prelims this time as well as for next time. Okay, and after that we'll be talking about something very grim, which is called the marital rape in India. And unfortunately in India, it is still permitted. It is still a legal crime. So in that context, we'll be talking about marital rape and the facets surrounding it. All right. And lastly, we'll be talking about the National Institutional Ranking Framework. So that's a quick takeaway topic. That's going to be a very small discussion only. That will not take much time. So our analysis today will have five topics with four comprehensive discussions and one quick takeaway topic. All right. And lastly, we'll conclude our sessions with some mains questions. So write the answers and post it in the comment section for peer review. So with that, let's move on to the discussion for today. Now look at this editorial. See, this editorial discusses about the National Registry of Citizens. In this context, we'll be discussing the Citizenship Amendment Act, the National Registry of Citizens, and also regarding the current move by the Foreigners Tribunal in Assam. All right. So let's get into the discussion. First, let us start by knowing the basic objective of the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019. See, this particular act is an amended version of Citizenship Act of 1955. And if you see, this Amendment Act aims to grant citizenship to members of six minority communities who have migrated to India from three different countries. And the six minority communities are Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis, and Christians. Okay. And the three countries that is mentioned in this amendment are Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Bangladesh. Okay. And as you can see, one particular religious minority in India has been excluded, and that is the reason why this particular act has also made news. And another thing that you'll have to notice, only those people will be granted citizenship through this route who have migrated to India before the 31st of December 2014. And if at all anybody who is belonging to these six minority communities or from these three countries, even if they have migrated to India after 2014, they will not be given any citizenship through this particular route. Okay. Keep this in mind. And those persons who have migrated to India, even without valid travel documents, or the members whose travel document validity has expired, will also be given citizenship based on this particular amendment act, provided they had come to India before 31st of December 2014 and they fulfill the other criteria of the six minority communities and these three countries. Okay. And here you need to know that two major amendments are important. First is Section 2 of the Citizenship Act of 1955. This Section 2 was amended by inserting a new clause for not treating these persons as illegal migrants, because we just saw even people who do not have valid travel documents will be granted citizenship. So Section 2, which deals with illegal migrants, had to be amended. And the next major amendment is to reduce the time period in acquiring the citizenship. Or in other words, to fast track the citizenship being granted to these people through naturalization. See, you may all by now will know that we have 5 ways of acquiring citizenship, and these 5 ways are prescribed in the Citizenship Act of 1955. So recollect with me, the first is by birth, second is by descent, and third we have by registration, and fourth we have by naturalization, and fifth by the incorporation of territory. So just understand that by birth means if an individual is born here, how the particular individual is granted citizenship, that is dealt with by birth. And by descent, what do you mean by descent? If either of your parents or your grandparents are Indians and you probably are in a different soil or in Indian soil, and how are you given citizenship is based on descent. And by registration, say a foreigner comes to India and he or she wants to get Indian citizenship, then they have to go to the government and they have to register themselves, and how they get citizenship is by registration. And by naturalization, we mean how long they stay in India and thereby they acquire the citizenship, that is by naturalization. And lastly, by incorporation of territory. Say for example, India acquires a territory from one of the neighboring countries, then the people living in that particular territory will become Indian citizens. So that is by incorporation of territory. Coming back to naturalization, which is what this particular act deals with, naturalization literally means the admittance of a foreigner to the citizenship of a country. Okay, and for these persons from this 6 communities that we just saw, from 3 countries, a provision has been inserted in the 3rd schedule as per the Amendment Act. As per this provision, the already existing period of not less than 11 years for acquiring citizenship through naturalization has been reduced to not less than 5 years for these persons only. Understand this, by naturalization, if a foreigner wants to get citizenship in India, it is 11 years. But if they belong to these 6 minority communities from these 3 countries, and if they have come to India before 2014, they just have to stay in India for 5 years. In that case, they will be granted citizenship. Okay, so we can see that the Citizenship Amendment Act helps in facilitating and fast-tracking the citizenship status of these persons. That is, they will get citizenship faster compared to people coming from any other country or from any other community. Okay, so remember, only for these set of persons the time period to acquire citizenship by naturalization has been reduced, and for every other person who wished to acquire citizenship through naturalization, the time period was not updated. So this is all about this Amendment Act that you'll need to know. Now you can see that one particular community, that is Muslim community, is excluded from this particular amendment. But note that people belonging to this community from these 3 countries can also acquire Indian citizenship. Doesn't mean that people belonging to this community from these countries cannot acquire. They can also acquire, but they will have to take the regular route of naturalization. That is, they will have to show that they stayed in India for longer than 5 years compared to the other community people. And this is why this particular piece of legislation was condemned, because it segregated people based on religion, whereas India is a secular country. That is, it does not discriminate people based on religion, but this particular act attempts to do so, and that is the exact reason why the CAA has been facing a backlash. Now coming back to the discussion, remember after CAA came into force in 2020, it saw widespread opposition from across the country. Especially the exclusion of Muslim community from this Citizenship Act has become a major concern among the Indian society and also among the opposition political parties. And many petitions were filed in Supreme Court to stay this act. Here the protesters
of the CAA also say that this act will make the National Registry of Citizens, which was published for Assam, as ineffective. Let us understand this. Before that, let's see what is NRC first. See, NRC for Assam was a promise made in the Assam Accord. So this particular NRC seeks to identify and deport the foreigners from Assam. That is, it is believed that Assam has a lot of influx from Bangladesh, right? And it has been alleged that these foreigners, they take away the resources that is meant for the natives. So in order to, you know, preserve the resources and rights of the local native people, this move was done. And know that under section 14A(1) of Citizenship Act of 1955, the central government may compulsorily register every citizen of India and issue national identity card to him or her. See, where you'll have to pay attention here is to the word may, okay? In the 1955 Act itself, the government has said that the government can register every particular citizen of India. But that exercise was never made, okay? Because there is a clause which says it is may, right? It may be compulsory, it may not be compulsory. So the government chose not to do it. And recently, under NRC, this particular action of the government has been validated through the section 14A(1) of Citizenship Act of 1955. All right. Now, section 14A(2) of the Act provides that the central government may maintain a national registry of Indian citizens. So the NRC is the register that contains the name of Indian citizens. And this register was prepared for first time after the conduct of census of 1951. And this is under the Ministry of Home Affairs. This is an extra information for preliminary exam. And these registers cover each and every person enumerated during the census of 1951. And ever since then, NRC is being updated for the first time. But it is updated only for the state of Assam. Now, let us discuss the issues specific to Assam, right? See, during 1971 of March, we remember that there was a war going on, yeah? And Assam witnessed massive illegal migration from Bangladesh because of the Bangladesh War of Independence. This has led to huge protests in Assam. And finally, the Assam Accord was signed between the government of India and the protesters in 1985. What did the protesters demand? We just saw. They wanted their land for themselves and they wanted to send back those people who migrated into India. So that was the issue. And they started protesting. And Assam Accord came into place in 1985 as a compromise. And one of the important provisions of Assam Accord was to find out the illegal migrants from Bangladesh. And in that direction, an NGO filed a petition in the Supreme Court. This was in 2009. So the NGO demanded the updation of NRC to find out the illegal migrants in the state. And the Supreme Court in 2013 said that the process to update the NRCs in Assam should be started. So that is how NRC started getting updated in Assam. So, in accordance with the Supreme Court order, the excise began 2 years later, that is in 2015. And remember that the objective of NRC was to segregate the Indian citizens living in Assam from those who illegally entered from Bangladesh. And the final NRC was published in August 31, 2019. And a lot of people were also excluded from the list. About 1.9 million people were excluded, or 19 lakh people were rendered stateless. And by the time NRC was published, it became evident that majority of those denied citizenship were Hindus or indigenous tribes. And it was at this time that the CAA came into force. That means the CAA gives citizenship to illegal migrants who were identified by the NRC. But it excludes the indigenous tribes. And that is exactly why the CAA-NRC nexus is very contentious and, frankly speaking, quite dangerous as well, because it excludes the indigenous people. So this was another reason why CAA saw opposition. So recently, what has happened is, coming back to the editorial, the Foreigners Tribunal in Assam, which is tasked with the work of identifying who is a legal citizen, who is an illegal citizen, right? So that is what it is tasked with. It tries to segregate the people who have illegally migrated from those who are residents or citizens of India. And a Foreigners Tribunal in Assam has held that the National Registry of Citizens does not require a revisit. We just saw about 19 lakh people have been rendered stateless, right? But still, even the government wanted to revisit it. But this Foreigners Tribunal has held that there is no need for revisiting it. The list that is published is final. See, this particular verdict of the Foreigners Tribunal has seen a mix of response, because firstly, the Hindu, from where we took out the article, in itself has said that there is no need to revisit NRC, it needs to be closed and it is a dangerous exercise. That is what the Hindu feels. Whereas the other experts believe that there is a need to revisit the NRC, because the NRC is not even registered with the Register General of India, which means its legality or the credibility of the document as a representative document of the government of India is very less. So it needs to be revisited, and the false inclusions or misrepresented inclusions and those who are excluded need to be accommodated as well. So these kind of discrepancies have to be taken care of. This is another set of opinion, whereas few do say that NRC exercise has to be stopped with this. So this is the mixed opinion that has been making rounds with respect to NRC. So summing up, in this part of discussion, what did we see? We saw about the Citizenship Amendment Act and the National Registry of Citizens, and what is the nexus between these two. And we also saw about the recent verdict by a Foreigners Tribunal from Assam on the status of the National Registry of Citizens. And we also saw what are the opinions given by various experts regarding the NRC. And remember, the NRC is not registered with the Register General of India. Keep this in mind, this is important for the preliminary exam. And another thing that you'll have to remember with this particular article is D voter, that is A, B, C, D, D for dog. D voter means doubtful voter. So this is an important preliminary area as well. So when a question asks you, what do you understand by D voter? It means doubtful voter, especially in the context of NRC. All right, keep that also in mind. So with that in mind, let us move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Now look at this op-ed. Recently, the World Bank Group has scrapped the Doing Business Report, famously called as the Ease of Doing Business Report. We all know that Doing Business Report is a flagship publication of the World Bank. We all might have memorized for our preliminary exam. This report published the influential annual ranking of countries on the Ease of Doing Business Index. So many of us were surprised by this decision of the World Bank when it was scrapped. And this article analyzes the ramifications of such cancellations, and it also discusses the inherent flaws of the EDB index. Here is the syllabus for your reference. First, let us see why was it cancelled. See, the World Bank has found major ethical issues in the preparations of 2018 and 2020 editions of the Ease of Doing Business Index. According to trusted sources, the CEO of the World Bank in 2018 exerted pressure on the internal working team on the Doing Business Report. So, this pressure was given to falsely boost China's ranking by doctoring the underlying data. That is, modifying the underlying data. And in addition to China, pressure was also given to boost rank of many other countries like Saudi Arabia. And these countries have used their political power to improve their ranking. So by falsely improving the rank, they wanted to polish their international image and sway public opinion. So because of these ethical violations, the World Bank has decided to cancel its Doing Business Report. See, this part of the discussion, so much that we have discussed, can be used in multiple areas. Okay. First, yes, of course, you can use it in economics topic. Basically, it's an economics topic, right? Second, you can use it in areas of governance because this is an area where corruption has been detected at one of the highest levels, that is in the World Bank. You can quote this as nepotism because the CEO has shown nepotism in favor of certain countries like China and Saudi Arabia. And besides, you can also use this particular incident in your ethics answer as well. Okay, so in areas of ethics, where you can use it is governance. And apart from that, you can also use it in economics discussion. So the upcoming part of this discussion will be based more on the economics aspect. But so far, just keep this particular incident in mind for mains exam. See, this decision to scrap this index by the World Bank has wide ramifications. This is because the ease of doing business index serves a variety of purposes because many countries are using this index to attract foreign investments. They say, I have a very good ranking in the ease of doing business, so bring money into my country and invest here and create jobs for my country. And national leaders often set ease of doing business targets as well. Even we have set targets. And they use this index to measure domestic policies against the global best practices. And they also use this particular index to justify their policies and silence domestic critics. For example, let us take our own country, India. India, for the past few years, wanted to break into the top 50 ranks of the ease of doing business. And see, we were heavily relying on this index to measure our improvements. So this directly infringes in our vision as well. See, according to the author, the ease of doing business index was never perfect. Even before the 2018 and 2020 ethical violations, this index has been suffering from flaws. Let us see that. See, the index ranks countries by the simplicity of rules framed for setting up and conducting business. That is in essence. But it is important to note that this index judges the countries as per the statute. It does not go into the actual practice. So that is a problem. A country may have a very progressive business-friendly laws in letter. A country may say you can bring in the investments whenever you want in whatever form. But in practice, there can be various hurdles. And these practical hurdles were not measured by the ease of doing business ranking. So according to the author, the ease of doing business index fails to capture the actual practice part. Again, take our own country for example. India ranked low around 130-140 till 2014 and all. However, it improved to 63rd position in 2019 and 20. It seems like a remarkable achievement. So when we just see the rank, we may think we are doing very great. But according to the author, the reality is different. Look at this particular table. See, the annual growth rate in GDP manufacturing and constant prices fell from 13.1% in, say, 2015-16 to minus 2.4% in 2019-20. So the net FDI inflow to GDP ratio has fluctuated around 1.5% only. And the fixed investment to GDP ratio fell from 30.1% in 2014-15 to 26.9% in 2019-20. Understand these data. So what is net FDI inflow to GDP ratio? So it is FDI inflow by GDP. Okay, so it measures the amount of FDI, that is the investments that come in, against the amount of investments that we make outside. So that is the net FDI inflow, that in comparison to the GDP. That particular ratio has not changed over the period from 2014 to 2020. It has remained the same, which means the investment friendliness of the country has remained the same. Now look at the next parameter, the fixed investment to GDP ratio at current prices. So fixed investment is the amount of investments that is being made in the country, which can be from outside or it can be from within the country. Fixed investments to the growth, GDP is the growth. So that apparently fell from 30 to 27, which means the amount of investments that are being made could be decreasing in actual picture. Whereas we saw that the ease of doing business ranking has improved for India remarkably. So we can say that ease of doing business is not painting the actual picture. See, another problem is that the ease of doing business index is constantly tweaking its underlying method. For example, take Chile or South America for that matter. Chile's rank on the EDB index sharply rose when the conservative government was in power. But its rank went down when the socialists took control of the country. So it is important to note that the socialist government made no changes in the policies and procedures. But still, change in government translated to change in rank. So you can say that the political currents are influencing the EDB rather than the actual business environment. Right? So we can say that the progress cannot be objectively captured if the methods are constantly changed. So these are the flaws. Now coming back to India's story, India wanted to improve our rank in the EDB index. So what did we do? We weakened our labor laws, their enforcements. For example, we dismantled the idea of official labor inspection systems. Now we are allowing employers to file self-regulation reports. So we have also allowed the private agencies to conduct critical safety regulations such as annual inspection and certification of industrial boilers. And our government has gone away from many of its responsibilities to increase our EDB index. And our government has reduced its interference to promote a free market, which in turn will be better for our rank. But this has created many problems. Think about the labor laws, okay? The labor laws are in place because they want to safeguard the laborers because they are prone to exploitation. Dismantling such delicate system can adversely affect the well-being of the laborers. And for example, we just saw that the inspection system has been dismantled. See, official labor inspection system allows for a government-appointed inspector come and visit a private facility and assess the labor situation there. Now there is no such system. So the government has let the businesses run their own kingdom in their own business. So the laborers are prone to being exploited at this particular scenario. These kind of changes has proven adverse for the vulnerable sections. And also in the recent years, issues like worker strike, industrial accidents, life and asset damages are on the rise. And according to the author, the lack of independent inspections and employers' self-reporting of labor law compliance are the main reasons behind these issues. See, we have taken drastic steps to improve our ranks in the EDB index, but now we have found the index to be flawed. And as I already said, it also suffers from ethical violations. So we have designed our policies and goals around a flawed index. This is a major problem. So according to the author, we should go for a better approach in designing our policies and programs rather than running behind the indices and setting goals based on some index which may or may not be objective. In this particular discussion, we saw why EDB was dismantled. We saw about the corruption and nepotism charges that has been placed on the chief executive officer. And like I said, the corruption and the nepotism charges and the entire fiasco is a very good example for your ethics paper, for your governance paper in your main exam. Okay, keep that in mind. And we also saw how basing our policies based on an external index, which may or may not be objective, has affected our trajectory of policy making. Okay, so this is an interesting discussion on how our country's priorities have changed based on some external factor. So with that information in mind, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Now look at this news. It is regarding the Botanical Survey of India. See, there is a publication by the Botanical Survey of India called the Plant Discoveries, and it was published in 2020. And in that publication, it has added about 267 new species to our country's flora. And it is important to note that the Western Ghats contributed more than 22% to the newly added species. See, we saw that about 267 new species has been added. But we in UPSC also tend to face questions about the new species. But not all species are important. Only those that appear in the newspaper. So before prelims, in case you're appearing for the prelims this time, just brush through the newly identified species, especially if they have some unique names, which is based on their geographic area or which is based on the scientist who has discovered not just plants, also the animal species. Just quickly go through it with special focus on the unique names, because there was a question in 2016 prelims on Musa andamanensis. So that is a banana species that was actually found in the Andaman Islands. So that was asked in 2016. It was an easy question with easy takeaway marks. So brush those things up if at all you're appearing for this time's prelims. All right. So coming back to the article, in this context, let us briefly see about the Western and the Eastern Ghats. See, the entire discussion is, of course, going to be beneficial for those appearing for prelims this time as well as the next time. And it will be a good revision for you if at all you're appearing this time. All right. See, the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats mark the western and the eastern edges of the Deccan Plateau. And we all know that the Western Ghats lie parallel to the western coast. And it is important to know that the Western Ghats are continuous range. But the Eastern Ghats, we can't say they are continuous, because see, most of the rivers in India are east flowing, right? So you can see the Kaveri or Krishna, Godavari, Mahanadi, everything is draining into the east. And when you see the Eastern Ghats, that is being interrupted by these rivers, making it as a discontinuous range compared to the Western Ghats. All right. So coming back to Western Ghats, a Western Ghat can be passed only through passes. Therefore, the Western Ghats have a lot of passes. The famous ones are the Talgat, Borgat and the Palgat passes. And see, when we are talking about the elevation about the Western Ghats and the Western Ghats have a higher elevation compared to the Eastern Ghats. And the average elevation of the Western Ghats is around 900 to 1600 meters. Now, a fun fact, compare it with the Mount Everest. The average elevation of the Western Ghats is 900 to 1600. Maybe it will go up to 2000, 2400. And the Eastern Ghats has an elevation of only 600 meters. That is the average. But think about Mount Everest. It has an elevation of 8,849 meters from the sea level. So you can imagine how mighty the Himalayas in comparison to the Western and the Eastern Ghats. So we can observe that the Western Ghats are higher than the Eastern Ghats. And also know that the Western Ghats cause orographic rain by facing the rain-bearing moist winds. So what is an orographic rain? See, this orographic rain is also called as the relief rainfall. See, the orographic rainfall happens when the moist air is lifted as it moves over a range of the mountain. And as the air rises and cools, the orographic clouds form and precipitation occurs, and thereby resulting in rainfall in the side which faces the wind. That is called as the orographic precipitation. The side that faces the wind is called as the windward side, and the one that is away from the wind, the other side, is called as the rain shadow region. And apart from that, we have convectional rainfall and cyclonic rainfalls as well. Cyclonic rainfalls are caused due to cyclones, and cyclonic rainfall is also called as frontal rainfall. Keep that in mind. And convectional rainfall happens when the moist air is raised due to the heat in the area, and which in turn results in rainfall. So that is convectional rainfall. The convectional rainfall is due to the convectional currents in the air, and that is exactly why the moisture bearing winds are also going up. And orographic or the relief rainfall happens due to the mountainous region. And we have cyclonic or frontal rainfall because of cyclones. Now coming back to the discussion on the Western and Eastern Ghats. Western Ghats are known by different local names. For example, Western Ghats are known as Sahyadri in Maharashtra. And we have Nilgiris in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. And in Kerala, it is commonly called as Annamanai Hills and Cardamom Hills. And also the height of the Western Ghats progressively increases from north to south, which means the southern region of the Western Ghats is taller compared to the Western Ghats in the northern region. The highest peak of Western Ghats is Anaimudi and Dottabetta. And the Western Ghats have important hill stations like Udagamandalam, and this is popularly called as Ooty. And we also have Kodaikanal, which is a very popular hill station in Tamil Nadu. And Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Kerala are the 6 Indian states covered by Western Ghats. So why are we studying this? Because there was a question asked in one of the previous year's preliminary exam about the states through which the Western Ghats exists. So the answer is 6, which is Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Okay, for the regular viewers, count the number of states through which the Eastern Ghats passes through. And the answer for the same will be given in the next session of mine. So if you know the answers, post it in the comment section and we'll review that. And also know that the Western Ghats are ecologically diverse. It has several type of forests like the green forest, the moist deciduous forest, the scrub jungles also we have, and savannas we have, and sholas also we have. So you should know about sholas. Sholas is an important area of questioning. See, the Shola forests are typical montane forests found in the valleys, separated by grasslands, and they're found only in the higher elevations. So it is a mixture of grasslands and trees. In general, the mountains are covered in grasslands and the trees never grow on the mountain tops. And finding the Shola forest at altitudes above 2000 meters of sea level is unique and curious as well. Keep that in mind about Sholas. Now coming back to Eastern Ghats. See, the Eastern Ghats stretch from Mahanadi Valley to the Nilgiris in the south. And the Eastern Ghats are discontinuous and irregular. And they are also dissected by rivers draining into the Bay of Bengal. And also know that the Javadi Hills, the Palconda Range, the Nallamala Hills and the Mahendragiri Hills make up some of the important mountainous hills of the Eastern Ghats. So pay attention to these hills. See, you will have to know the north to south order of these hills also. Okay, when you are reading the map. So pay attention to that order and read the Eastern Ghats and the Western Ghats. Okay. So with that information in mind, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Now let us take up this editorial article written by the senior IPS officer. This article essentially talks about marital rape and also the need to abolish or get away with the exception provided to it in the IPC. So this is the ultimate crux of this editorial. With this idea in mind, let us look at the important points. This is the syllabus relevant for this particular editorial. Take a note. See, as we know, marital rape, or otherwise called as spousal rape, is the act of sexual intercourse with one's spouse without the spouse's consent. So you'll have to pay attention to the consent part. Without the spouse's consent. So it is one among the many acts of domestic violence that is exhibited. But unfortunately, marital rape is a non-criminalized crime in India. Recently, 2 High Court judgments on marital rape made headlines. The first is the High Court of Kerala. Another one is the Chhattisgarh High Court. The Kerala High Court's judgment is quite progressive. It held that the acts of marital rape are a kind of mental cruelty. So therefore, marital rape is a good ground for divorce. And the Chhattisgarh High Court's judgment was quite conservative. It was criticized for being conservative. But even then, it underlined that the charge of rape framed under Section 376 of IPC was erroneous and illegal regarding the exception too. See, the court judgments have once again brought to light the debate regarding the constitutionality of this particular exception to the section of 375 of the IPC. See, what is this 375? The 375 of IPC deals with sexual offences, especially rape. And this section lists down various sexual acts which are covered under rape. And it also provides the circumstances at which such acts are considered rape. But as you can see, this has given 2 exceptions where the acts will not be considered a rape. So as you can see, the first circumstance is when it is done for medical purposes. Okay. And the second circumstance is when the sexual intercourse is done by a man with his own wife, provided she is over the age of 18. In simple words, being sexually involved with a woman of over 18 years of age without her consent is not a crime if she is a legal wife of a person. So look at the provision, how draconian it is. A person can go unscathed if at all he rapes his own wife without the consent, and this in turn forms a ground of domestic violence, as we saw earlier. And know that India is one among the few countries where marital rape is still not criminalized. In fact, even the government, when this discussion was brought up before the Supreme Court, had said that criminalizing marital rape could destabilize the institution of marriage. And that was the ground given by the government to resist criminalizing marital rape. So that is the sad state of affair in which India is in right now. And this need to criminalize marital rape was highlighted in the report of Justice Verma Committee 2013. And as per the report, the marital rape is considered to be a criminal offense in countries like South Africa, Australia, Canada, and all. And know that the committee actually recommended to remove the exceptions for marital rape. But this suggestion never saw the light by the government. And likewise, even the Andhra Pradesh High Court expressed the reservations for the particular provisions because there is a high chance for the exception to be misused by a husband for enforcing sexual intercourse with his wife. However, the Supreme Court overruled it as well. And see, some people are of the view that once marital rape is criminalized, it may lead to filing of false charges against the husbands. See, that is a defensive argument given by many. See, this is not the case because a person will be accused of a crime only after a thorough research based on facts and evidences and not as and when the police prefer. Even if it is an untrue accusation, there are legal provisions to deal with false cases. And if found ineffective, the legal remedies may be revised suitably. So this is not a valid ground to resist criminalization of marital rape. Likewise, some also think that it will be very difficult for the police to prove such cases beyond reasonable doubt. And this again doesn't hold water because the difficulty of proof cannot be the criterion for not notifying a unjust or a deviant behavior. That is, just because I can't find evidence, just because the evidence is missing, we cannot justify a behavior as correct, isn't it? So that is the argument presented here. And as we all are aware, in modern times, marriage is considered to be a partnership of equals. In the sense, marriage is seen as an association of two individuals, with each of them having their own separate integrity and dignity. So on that lines, violating the bodily integrity of a woman is a clear violation of her autonomy as well. In fact, the European Commission of Human Rights has stated that a rapist remains a rapist regardless of his relationship with the victim. So the person who is being raped, that is a victim, may be a wife or not. The crime is a rape. So, to conclude, any provision of law which is not found to be reasonable, just and fair, and which is against the spirit of Article 21, that is protection of life and personal liberty of the Constitution, is something that is discriminatory and arbitrary. And therefore, such provisions must be declared unconstitutional. And in that regard, it is advisable to abolish the exception to the marital rape. And since doing it not only exhibits the state's non-tolerance to rape, but also makes the institution of marriage more fairer and more equal. So what is the use of an institution of marriage which can always subjugate one person to the other? So a fairer and an equal marriage is much more essential. So with this takeaway, understand that in India, marital rape is not a crime. We saw that, and we saw arguments why marital rape should be considered a crime in India and how many other countries have criminalized marital rape and how it is a violation of right to life. And we also saw about the European Commission of Human Rights stand on this particular issue. So these are the basic takeaways that you'll have to keep in mind regarding the marital rape issue. With that information in mind, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Now look at this particular news article. See, this article talks about National Institutional Ranking Framework. See, I'm not going to get into the substance of the article because that is not very relevant for our exam perspective. But you will have to know the basics of the NIRF from the preliminary point of view. So let me just briefly tell you what all you'll have to know about NIRF. See, the National Institutional Ranking Framework, that is NIRF, is released yearly since 2016, because it was approved in 2015 and was released for the first time in 2016 by the Ministry of Human Resources Development. And the ministry right now is called as the Ministry of Education. And since 2016, it has been released every year. See, when it was initially released, it had very few categories. But right now, the ranking is listed for 7 categories of colleges or streams. Okay. And the last stream that was added was in 2020. It is for dental category, all right? So remember that these are the very basic things you will have to remember. You don't have to remember which college topped, which ranking and all. That is all very factual, which the UPSC does not touch upon. So you should know National Institutional Ranking Framework has been released yearly from 2016. It was approved in 2015 and it has 7 categories. And the latest addition was in 2020. Okay, this is all you'll have to know about the National Institutional Ranking Framework. The quick takeaway article this is. So with that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. See, look at this particular article. This article endgame is about the bad banks. Okay, and a few days ago in Vensi ma'am's discussion, we saw about this topic in detail, especially in Sunday, I guess. So we are not going to touch upon it again. This bad bank topic is very important from the main exam point of view. So keep that in mind, and also preliminary exam requires you to remember the factual aspects about the structuring, functioning and all you'll have to remember. Alright, so brush it up again from the Sunday's video and look at this particular topic. This topic is about the Kudumbashree mission. Already in one of the previous sessions itself, we have discussed about the Kudumbashree mission. In fact, twice we have discussed. So I'm not going to repeat it again. See, this Kudumbashree mission is something of a case study type. Okay, you can quote it in the exam paper, which is relevant to self-help groups and empowerment of women and women employment. All these areas are potential questions which can require a case study, and Kudumbashree mission will be an ideal fit there. Okay, so with that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Okay, with that, we are almost at the closure of the session. We have only one practice questions for discussion today, and this is based on the Citizenship Amendment Act and the NRC. Let's look at it. In 2019, the final update of NRC was published by the Government of India. In this context, consider the following statements. Three statement question. So it was the first time the NRC was updated. See, in the discussion, we saw that yes, despite finding its place in the 1955 statute, this was the first time NRC is being updated. The register covers each and every person enumerated during the census of 1951. So the first statement is correct. Moving on to the second statement. It was updated for the entire of nation. See, this is a blatantly wrong statement because we all know NRC is updated only for the state of Assam. And government is trying to push it for the entire nation, but it is still not materialized. So statement 2 is wrong. See, this is an easy question. Why? We all know statement 2 is wrong. Someone who is following the news even roughly will know that statement 2 is wrong. Okay, now come to the options. We see that statement 2 is there in option A, option C, option D. So let us eliminate all the options which contains statement 2. Then we'll be left only with statement B. So only with elimination technique we'll be able to arrive at the answer, which is 1 and 3. But for knowledge sake, let me also go through the third statement. The objective of updating NRC was to identify illegal immigrants from Bangladesh. See, this statement is also correct. We saw this in the discussion. So, the right answer is option B, 1 and 3 only. So, with that, let's conclude the discussion on the practice preliminary question.
So, that brings us to the end of today's discussion. So, here are some of the main questions. Write the answers, post it in the comment section for peer review. See, writing answers is very important. I'm talking to those students who are not appearing for preliminary this time. So, those who are appearing for next time, start writing today. Every day, you will be able to cover one or two topics comprehensively when you're reading it yourself. All right. So, post it in the comment section and let's wrap up our discussion with that. So, wear a mask, stay safe. Good day.